Thank you very much for that kind introduction. I must say I'm deeply flattered to be on YouTube. And provided I can get one of my grandchildren to explain how it operates, I might even watch what I've said at a later time. Let me begin by thanking Nikos Lavranos, the committee of EFILA, and also the different sponsors for inviting me here this evening and inviting me to give the third annual EFILA lecture. It's always very nice to be invited to give a lecture. It's particularly nice if it's not the first in the series. You feel a sort of responsibility for making sure that there is a second. It's said that George Bernard Shaw once wrote to Winston Churchill, whom he detested, enclosing two tickets for the first night of Shaw's new play, with just a little note saying, "Winston, bring a friend if you have one." And Churchill wrote a delightful note back saying he was very sorry he was otherwise occupied that evening, but I'll come to the second night, if there is one. But having got to the third lecture, EFILA has clearly met the Bernard Shaw, Winston Churchill test. And my chosen subject this evening is most favoured nation clauses, or MFN clauses for short, in BITs. Yes, I think I'd better not masquerade as somebody else. About 25 years ago, I gave an interview for ITN, the day before Christmas, when, as you may well realise, many people in television studios have only a hazy contact with reality because of the number of parties they've been to. And they broadcast my entire interview with the name of the Israeli defence attaché at the embassy in London and his interview with my name underneath it. I don't know which of us was at greater danger as a result of that. Yes, most favoured nation clauses, or MFNs for short. Now, it would have to be said that they have prompted a debate which is perhaps best characterised as spirited amongst the investment law community. On one side, they are regarded as one of the salvations of international investment law, a clause which unlocks the technicalities and allows the investor to get the best of the protective provisions in any treaty that the host state may have concluded. If you like that board game Monopoly, it's a sort of get-out-of-jail-free clause. On the other side, they're seen as the villain of the piece, the worst aspect of investment protection. Exploited by unscrupulous investors and law firms so as to set aside the carefully crafted compromise in a treaty and allow a sophisticated investor to set aside the protection that the host state has managed to negotiate for itself in the particular treaty on which that investor is relying. And nowhere is that debate more vigorous than over the question of whether an MFN clause can be used to expand the scope of the investor's right to seek arbitration under the dispute settlement provision. Now, on a recent study suggested that there are now in excess of 50 arbitration awards which deal with the effects of MFN clauses in bilateral investment treaties, roughly half of which address this thorny question about the MFN clause and the dispute settlement provision. If ever there was living proof of the maxim that art is long but life is short, it's the looking through all of the MFN arbitration awards on one of the big sites like Italaw. And so you may be relieved to know I'm not going to try and offer a summary of all 50 of these awards. I want instead to ask a few questions about the purpose of MFN clauses and how they go about, how they are interpreted as serving that purpose. Because I think that if you look at it closely enough and look at the MFN clauses in the light of first principles of public international law, much of the debate can be resolved. Not all of it, and I'm not going to try and offer any simple answers in this evening's lecture, though I dare say I shall manage to commit myself to such an extent that I am unappointable in any future arbitration where the effect of the MFN clause is one of the issues before us. But before I start on the substance, there has to be a brief word of warning. I have a problem about MFN clauses, and it has nothing whatever to do with investment law. When I graduated from Cambridge in 1976, it was the hottest summer in Britain for over 50 years. So it was perhaps unfortunate that the job I had managed to fix up for myself, in order to pay off a part of the student debt, which seemed a lot in those days, but is a drop in the ocean compared with what students have today, was working on an experimental pig farm. It was a very hot summer. There was a water shortage. We were not allowed to have showers when we finished work. I always managed to get a seat to myself on the bus going home without the slightest difficulty. Now, it was an experimental farm because they were trying out various experimental forms of pig food. So we had to keep scrupulous records about each piglet from birth to the slaughterhouse to see how it fattened up and everything. And those records included details of the sow and the sire which had produced this little pig. Now, there were only five boars, and they were all given working initials. And by far and away, the most prolific breeder on the farm was known as MFN. Now, I have absolutely no idea why it was given those initials, although a not entirely healthy image does present itself. But the result is every time I read an arbitration award or a piece of academic writing about the MFN clause, the image that comes to mind is of a very frisky sanglier wandering around the sow's area in this experimental pig farm in Bedfordshire. So I hope you'll bear with me if occasionally that spectre is still looking over my shoulder. Now, given that spectre of the prolific father, let's begin by looking at the parenthood of the MFN clause itself. Now, MFN clauses go back many centuries before anything approaching a bilateral investment treaty. Schwarzenberger, in one of his studies of the subject, maintained that the very first MFN clauses appeared in trade agreements concluded between England and various continental countries during the Middle Ages. The British government is currently working on how to do exactly the same thing by way of negotiating agreements of this kind at the moment. Now, as such, those clauses were not about investor protection. They were about tariffs and non-tariff barriers, as we've now called. And they were designed to ensure that the traders of each state party received the benefit of the same lower tariffs and removal of quotas that might have been negotiated with a third country. And it's not difficult to see, in the highly competitive environment of international trade, why you need a clause of that kind. If you are an English wool merchant and you have managed to take advantage of an agreement between the kings of England and France, whereby English wool can be imported into France at only a 10% duty, your entire business model could collapse if Dutch merchants managed to negotiate a 5% tariff for their imports. But it's not quite so easy to see why you need an MFN clause in an investor protection agreement. Now, it's true that it's useful to have a level playing field. If you're a German company investing in Britain, you would want to know that a French company investing in Britain would not get the benefit of better terms. But investments tend to be long-term matters. They're not directly affected by the availability to another car manufacturer of a better, fair and equitable treatment clause, or a more generous provision on expropriation. That is not going to have anything like the direct impact that non-discrimination in relation to tariffs and non-tariff barriers will have on an importer. So I've often wondered quite how we ended up with MFN clauses coming into the 2,500 or so EITs that are in force. And although I haven't been able to verify that, I think that the answer is that they first appear in the Friendship, Commerce and Navigation treaties that were very popular between the wars and just after the Second World War, and which of course dealt primarily with trade, but also with elements of investor protection. And that is the antecedent for the MFN clause that we're concerned with today. Nevertheless, there's no question at all that MFN clauses in BITs are here to stay, and that they play a very important role. I haven't done a count of how many BITs contain an MFN clause, but it's certainly a majority and probably a very substantial majority. So what is the purpose that they serve? The principal purpose is surely that level playing field. It was emphasised by the tribunal in India and Pakistan. It is a guarantee to the investor of non-discrimination. And so in that respect, it's very closely related to the national treatment clause, which tends to appear in bilateral investment treaties. Indeed, many BITs roll national treatment and most favoured nation treatment into one, even though the practical effects can often be very different indeed. And I think it's worth keeping that point in mind. It's a matter of non-discrimination, a substantive obligation not to discriminate. Now, we would always see a national treatment provision in that light. I think we have been distracted from seeing MFN clauses in the same way because of some of the uses to which they have recently been put. And if it's a non-discrimination provision, what do we mean by discrimination in this context? Obviously, there is discrimination if better treatment is actually given to an investor from a third country. But is it enough that that investor operates under a treaty that has a better clause from the investor's point of view? Take an example that you get in many of the treaties involving the former communist states of Eastern Europe, which tended to have somewhat eccentric provisions about expropriation, to modernise at least, and often no provision on fair and equitable treatment. If you are an investor from a state whose treaty with the host state contains no F&E clause, and your main competitive rival does have the benefit of an F&E clause, is that the mere fact of that difference in the treaty regime discriminatory, and thus something to activate the MFN clause? Now that's an unresolved dispute. It's difficult, to my mind, to see how you can insist upon actual discrimination, because the very fact that an investor operates knowing that it has the backup of a more favourable regime may in itself be beneficial. If you take it in a pure economic way, you are more likely to extend your investment, to take a greater level of risk, if you know that you have this better insurance provision behind you. So on the whole, I think the non-discrimination guarantee is a guarantee not merely against actual discrimination, but against the existence of discriminatory regimes. Now, in the light of that, let's look at the debate in the various awards about how a most favoured nation clause operates. Let's take the simple practical example. An investor of state A invests in state B, relying on the protection of a bilateral investment treaty between A and B. We'll call it the primary treaty, or if you like, the base treaty for these purposes. And the way in which the MFN clause is generally invoked is that the investor claims that as a result of it, the investor can latch on to a more attractive set of provisions in B's treaty with C or D or E, the secondary bilateral investment treaty. So, for example, if there is no fair and equitable treatment clause, which was the issue in India in Pakistan, but the host state has another BIT which does contain a fair and equitable treatment clause, you can use the MFN clause in the first treaty to take advantage of the fair and equitable treatment provision in the second. Similarly, with more generous provisions on expropriation. Now, I think it's worth asking, is the rather glib assumption that we make that an MFN clause can be used in this way, is that actually setting aside the will of the parties? Let me give you a practical example without naming names. I advised a government about a BIT that it had concluded. Incidentally, it was unaware it had this BIT until the claim was brought. It's worth keeping in mind that many of the older BITs were concluded by trade ministries in foreign countries as part of the photo opportunity that went with the visit of the trade minister of one of the bigger investment exporting countries. And, shall we say, the filing system wasn't quite as good as it might have been, and neither the foreign ministry nor the Ministry of Justice, Attorney General's Office, or whoever dealt with litigation was ever made aware.